Go ahead and grab your Bibles, open them up to John chapter 19. If you don't have a Bible and you need one, there are some right over here near the entrance. You can grab one there, or if you need help getting one, raise your hand. We'll get one to you. We will make sure that you get one. I definitely want you to be able to have a Bible. I think it's important for you to be able to see the scriptures with your own eyes. And if you don't have one, if you don't have a means of getting a Bible, then please take one of those as our gift to you. We would love for you to have that. Here's our contract. If you take one, you read it, right? That's the only thing I care about is that if you can take it as long as you're going to read it. So please do that. So we're in John chapter 19, verse 30 today. We're looking at the sixth saying of our seven sayings of Jesus from the cross. We have one more next week, and then we'll be completing this series. But today we're looking at a saying of completion. My wife, Micah, and I, we bought a car. Have you ever had that experience? Isn't that just terrible? We bought a car, and we picked it based on being young and having no children. And so we just went for cool, right? That's all you really care about. What can I afford and what looks awesome? And so we bought a car, and we were trying to buy something, trying to be a little wise and make sure that we got something that was going to be durable and last and had a good reputation. And so we bought a car, and what we didn't realize about this car was that it required synthetic oil. And if you know anything about synthetic oil, you know that it's about 2 to 3 times more expensive than regular oil. And so when we took it in to go get the oil changed, they said, we recommend synthetic oil. And we said, well, is it necessary? They go, no. And we said, well, we're young and we're cheap, so we'll go with the cheaper one. And so they did that. And so that lasted not quite 2 years before the car decided it was going to just die. And so just so you know, if your car needs synthetic oil, we learned the hard way. We killed a car. By not doing that. You should probably use synthetic oil. And so we did that, and so the car died. It was in the middle of a trip. We were driving to Arizona on a trip, and it died in the middle of it. So we had to rent a different car and leave ours. Anyway, it was a big nightmare. Well, when we got back, we decided, what are we going to do with this car? Do we put the money into fixing it, or do we trade it in? And when we kind of weighed it all out, we decided that the best thing to do would be to trade it in. So we traded in this car, and we got another car. So now we went to this other dealership, and we rolled these two loans into one, right? So now we're paying twice as much for a car. This is awesome. Anybody else have this experience? Or am I the only dumb one in the room? Yeah. Terrible, terrible stuff. So now we're paying twice as much as this car is worth for this car. And, you know, we tried to do what we could to be a little bit smarter, plan for the future. And we didn't realize we were going to have as many kids as we did. So that one didn't last as long as we thought. But, you know, it lasted a little while longer. So we get this car, and now we have this massive payment that we ended up paying for a little over 7 years on this car. And here's the terrible part. So we were young and broke, so all we could do was make our car payment. We couldn't even afford gas to put into it to go anywhere with it. So it was terrible. Yeah, we have this car, but we can't do anything with it. And so we pay this car down, and we pay it down, and we pay it down until one day, finally, we made the final payment. The final payment came through, and the car no longer belonged to the bank. It then belonged to us. An amazing, amazing moment. Such a moment of relief. It was like getting a raise in that moment. I don't have to give this massive car payment any longer to the bank, and now I can just enjoy this vehicle. Well, that only lasted a few years because we moved out here and I wrecked that car. So thanks for that. The great thing about that is the Lord used that money. I believe that the Lord wrecked it. But we used that money, and that's how we lived for the first couple of months in the transition period of moving out here. So, you know, it was pretty amazing the way the Lord did that. But in all of that, this payment finally came through, and it was the vehicle we had and the vehicle before were now paid in full. It was finished. Now, with us, sinfulness against God, that's what it is. Sinfulness is against God, and therefore it's indebtedness to God, right? So that, grasp my dumb car analogy, and let's take that into this idea that sinfulness is against God and is therefore indebtedness to God, and that's the basis for what we're looking at today. You see, this reality can create a deep sense of hopelessness, because if you've ever experienced what it is to be strapped down by debt and you have so much debt you don't know what to do with it, you feel like no matter what we do, it doesn't matter. It's like putting a drop in the ocean. What's it going to matter? Let me tell you, it does matter, so just pay off your debt. But it feels like it doesn't matter. And sometimes we get that feeling in ourselves because of our sinfulness, that I'm so indebted to God, I could never pay him off. I could never do enough. And sadly, that thought, that reality, sometimes is what keeps people away from the Lord. It's what keeps people away from church. They think that, you ever had that conversation with somebody that they said something, my mom had this boyfriend and he used to say, I can't go to church because lightning will strike me if I go in the building. And it was like, ha ha ha. But you know, really that's what he was feeling. Like, I cannot go to God, that I have so much sin. There's so much in my past that God would never accept me. And let me tell you, he absolutely receives anyone who will come to him. There's nothing you've done that's so heinous that he can't forgive it. There's nothing in your past that's so difficult that he can't overcome it. That he is a redeeming, life-changing God. Romans chapter 7 describes this idea for us, and I struggled with this because it's kind of a large piece to grasp all the ideas, but here's a few verses. Romans 7:21-24 says this. It's Paul is writing and he's describing this idea, and I think it's something that we all can identify with. It says this: I've discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what's wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another power within me that is at war within my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? I think that that encapsulates for us where a lot of us find ourselves even after coming to the Lord. This is where Paul was at after coming to the Lord. This is post-salvation. This is where he was in this position of struggling, saying, I love God. I want to serve God. I want to do what's right. There's this desire in me to do what's right and godly and appropriate. And yet there's also something else within me that even though I know what's right and I want to do what's right, I'm dragged away from it. And I fall headlong into what is folly. And I'm so frustrated by it. And I feel like I'm just such a miserable wretch. And who's going to save me? And the very next verse is amazing in that, where he says that Jesus is the one who saves you, that he's the one who overtakes and overcomes all of this. You see, it's one of the major reasons, like we said before, that people stay away from church. It's because too much debt makes you lose hope that the debt could ever be paid. And that is supposed to be a feeling that we have, that my sinfulness is so overwhelming. But it's designed to drive you toward Jesus, not away from him. Not bring you to the point to where you can't come to the Lord, but instead to say, I have no hope but you, and that you realize that his love is so deep for you. This debt hangs over us, and it's not been paid off throughout all of human history. All the people who have sacrificed and they've given up and they've lived their lives to try to do what's best, it's not paid off the debt. All the sacrifices of the Old Testament over and over and over again show us that it cannot be paid. It just stays over us. What is our hope? What can we do? You see, our debt is so massive and overwhelming that God himself is the only one who can pay the debt. And that is what we're going to be looking at this morning. That is the entire backdrop of what happens at the cross of Jesus. So here's our big idea today. Here's what we're going to be looking at. The debt you owe is paid only through the cross of Jesus. The debt you owe is paid only through the cross of Jesus. So let's look at John chapter 19. For context, we're going to start in verse 28, but we're going to be looking today at verse 30. All right, so John 19:28-30 says this. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Today we're going to be looking at this section in three parts, three different things we're going to look at in this this piece of scripture, verse 30, in this specific saying of Jesus, it is finished. We're going to look at, number one, what Jesus says. Secondly, what Jesus means. And thirdly, what Jesus does. All right, so there's our three pieces and three parts we're going to look at concerning this idea of what Jesus says here on the cross. Now, firstly, we see that Jesus says something there. Look at there. If your Bible has red letters, I love that. It makes it really easy to identify. He says three words there. It is finished. This is what Jesus says. These final four sayings, like we said last week, they all happen in rapid succession of one another. That when Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Right after that, we see that someone goes and gets him this sour wine, this drink. And then right after that, he says, it is finished. And then immediately after that, he says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. That's where we're going to be next week. So these final four sayings of Jesus, they happen really fast. One right on top of the other. Previous to this, when we were looking at the other three sayings of Jesus, they happen over extended period of time, over hours of time. And these final four, they happen all together. And they do so happening in such rapid succession that the gospel writers identify different ones as the final word before Jesus dies. When you read here, this seems to be the final thing that Jesus says, because it reads very clearly, it is finished, and then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit, okay? Now, when you read in Luke's gospel, you find that he says something else, that there's another thing that he says after this. And when you read Matthew and Mark, you see that when he says, my God, why have you forsaken me, that's the last thing he says. Anyone worried about their Bible and they're going to throw it away now? You shouldn't be. Don't worry about that. This is one of those things that people try to say, hey, you can't trust your Bible. Like, look at all the, I mean, no one even knows what he said last. How crazy. It's all, there's discrepancies within the Bible. Whenever people say that, they're just saying things. They're repeating stuff that they heard from some sort of atheist professor in college that is actually not true. This is one of the actual proofs of Scripture, not a disproof of Scripture. And here, let me tell you why. You see, it's only as we piece all of their accounts together that we find the full picture of the work of Jesus on the cross. This is how it works when people witness things. When you see eyewitness accounts of things, if everyone has the same exact accounting with the same wording in the same order, you think, something's fishy about this story. Why does everyone have the exact same story? Now, they should have the same story, but because of you and your perspective and your experience, you're going to focus on certain things. You may see details that I missed. You may see things that stand out to you that I just gloss over. So there's going to be parts of it that stand out in your mind. That when we look at these four different gospel writers and we see that their accounts line up and they all tell the same story, there's just different details that stand out to each of them. That is not a disproof of the Bible. It's actually a massive undergirding and proving of the Scriptures. It's one of the major reasons you can support the Bible, that you can believe in the Bible, is that these are not some sort of written things that these guys got together and said, hey, here's our story. Everyone just say this, okay? It's something deeper than that. It's something true and real that's happening in all of this. Now, there's this saying that the Greeks had. The Greeks, this is, our New Testament is written in the Greek language, and there's a saying that the Greek people had. They said that they would put an ocean of matter into a drop of language. Now, that's one of their sayings. They long to try to fill a single word with depth of meaning and emotion and strength and vitality within just a single drop of language. And when you look at how archaic the English language is by comparison, you see that this is absolutely true. That they are, the Greek language is filled with depth. And so we're going to get a little nerdy today, and I'm going to give you a little bit of a language study, okay? So you're going to feel like you're going right back to 10th grade, you know, English class or whatever, and oh no. But trust me, it's worth it. It actually means something. And today as we look at these three words of Jesus in English are actually a single word in Greek. It's only a single word in Greek, and this is the exact embodiment of that concept, that it is an ocean of meaning in a drop of language. That's what we're looking at today. You see, here in this single word, we have the grace of God wrapped up in this word. We have the mercy of God, the judgment of God, the forgiveness of God, God's hatred towards sin, the love of God, the glory of God, the humility of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God. All of this wrapped up in this single word. You see, we not only do we have that, but we have the redemption of humanity, past, present, and future, wrapped up in this word. We have the adoption of humanity into the family of God, the transformation of the human heart to be like the divine, the ability for sinful humanity to find freedom from their depravity. We have acceptance of humanity that should be rejected, all wrapped up in this single word. You see, what we have here in this single word is the entire basis for our salvation and acceptance into relationship with God. It is the gospel packaged into a single word. It's an ocean of meaning in a drop of language. And so here we see what this word is, and it's only used in two places in the entirety of the New Testament. The first place it's used is two verses before, in verse 28. Look back at verse 28 with me, if you would. It says this, "And after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished," same word. This is kind of one of the things that John does in the way that he writes. If you read 1 John, you'll notice that this happens quite often with the way he writes. He revisits concepts over and over again, and he approaches them from different angles. It's like he's dropping hints along the way about what he's going toward, and this is what he's doing here. In verse 28, he says a word, and then in verse 30, he repeats that word. It's like a foreshadowing of what he's about to say. He's setting up the dominoes so that when he pushes them over, you get the full weight of what's taking place. This word that he uses here means so much, we would do well to understand it. So I wanted to write it up here on the screen for you. The word is tetelestai. That's the Greek word, tetelestai. It comes from, it's a verb of the word teleo, but this is, it's tetelestai. That's the word. This is only used twice in the entirety of the New Testament. And what it means is, it means to bring to a close, to finish, to end, to perform, to execute, or to complete. There's a whole lot happening within this single word. And there's a lot of it that we don't grasp because, like I said, the English language is quite archaic, and we only have a couple of different layers to the words that we use, but the Greek people, they had multiple layers within a single word. And so, based on the structure, the grammatical structure of the word, you could gain insane amounts of meaning from a single word by the way they structured it, okay? So I want to look at with you the grammatical structure of this word, tetelestai. There's three parts to it of this single word. There's the tense, the voice, and the mood. You're like, man, I didn't know I was going to English class today, okay? Tense, this matters, okay? This matters. I'm not just telling you stuff so that you think I'm smart, because I'm not. I read it in a book, okay? I don't know Greek. I know someone who knows Greek, and so I steal from him. Tense, voice, and mood. Okay, these are massively important. Okay, we are going somewhere. Tense, voice, and mood. Mood. It's written in the perfect tense. The perfect tense. Perfect tense means that it's been completed. It's an action that's been completed, and the result of that action is ongoing with full effect. Okay, it's something that was done, and the results continue on with full effect. Similar to when you throw a pebble into a pond, how it creates ripples. But think about if those ripples were to continue with the same force as when the pebble initially dropped, that it continued and perpetually rippled for all of eternity with the same force. That's the perfect tense. It's not imperfect. It doesn't end. It is perfect. It never ends. It's completely full. The second piece of this is passive. It's a passive voice. This is to say that it represents the subject as being the recipient of the action or the one being acted upon. Okay, so you're like, okay, you read out of a dictionary there. Okay, so what that means is, so if you take the sentence, the boy was hit by the ball, this passive voice, the boy is the subject. He's the one receiving being hit by the ball. There's this passive application to it. So it's the perfect passive, and the third piece is indicative voice. What this means is it's a statement of fact or actual occurrence from the writer's or speaker's perspective. It's a statement of fact or actual occurrence, something that actually took place. Not, I hope it doesn't snow later today, even though I know it probably will. It's not that, okay? It's something that actually has happened. It's not something where, you know, you tell your buddies about the fishing trip that you had. And you're like, hey, I caught the fish. It was this big, you know? You're telling the truth about this. It took place. The truth is, I didn't catch any fish. We got skunk, but I wanted to tell you we got a really big one, right? So the truth of it, of the matter, it's that I'm telling you exactly what took place. That's the indicative mood. And so this means a ton. This is an ocean of information and meaning in this single word. What this means is that it's not just over. When Jesus says it's finished, he's not just saying that it's over. It's just done. I'm past that now. It's not like when your show is over and you turn off the show. It's not done. It's not over. It's something more than that. That there's a specific purpose being accomplished. You catch that nuance within this word? It is finished carries a lot of purpose and on purpose within it. That it didn't just happen by accident or it didn't just happen to be done. It does not ever need to be accomplished again because it's done. It's been completed. Okay, so I want to read some verses for you to kind of illustrate this. I'm going to put them on the screen for you. I got four verses I want to read for you that we'll put up on the screen. But they capture this concept a little bit for us. Number one, Romans 6:10. It says this, "For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God." The word that I want you to capture in all of these verses is once. Once. It's accomplished. It's finished. It's done. He died this death once. That Jesus doesn't need to die again. That even though I've accepted the forgiveness of Christ on my behalf, that when I sin later on today, because odds are pretty good that I will, Jesus doesn't need to go to the cross again. That his death was enough for all the sin that I don't even know I'm going to commit yet. He covered all that too. He died once. Hebrews 7, 26 through 27 says this. "For such a high priest," speaking of Jesus, "was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifices for his own sins, and then for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once for all when he offered up himself." He did it. He did it once for all. And then a couple chapters later, Hebrews 9:28. "So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many, to those who eagerly wait for him. He will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation." He offered himself once. Once, not again and again. 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit." You see, Jesus did this once. There's no further work to be done. There's no extra that needs to be accomplished. There's nothing that you need to do. There's nothing that you could do to ever take away from the work of Jesus, that he has completed it. That you are not powerful enough to accomplish your own salvation or to lose it. That if it's given to you by Jesus, it's given to you. He's God, you're not. You are secure in him. There's no amount of sin you can do that would ever make God say, "You're out of the family, sorry." It's a matter of coming to him with it and receiving the forgiveness that he is extending. And living in that reality. You see, when Jesus says this, he's saying that it's completed. It's all done. There's no need to suffer any longer or ever again. It's an amazing concept. So Jesus says this word, but not only does Jesus say this word, but what does he mean by this word? Because it's quite easy for us. It's easy for us to hear what somebody says, but miss the point, but miss the meaning behind what they're saying. You see, the entire point of understanding what someone says is to grasp what they mean. The question is, what are they communicating with their chosen words? right? Well, what are they trying to say? What are they getting across? I mean, Jesus selected some really specific words. And like we've said before, that speaking from the cross was agonizing pain. That in order to breathe, you'd have to lift yourself up on the nails. And the fire that would shoot down through your arms. And as Jesus pressed down with his feet and his raw back beaten and bloodied and torn apart, rubbing against the cross, that he pulls himself up in order to speak. If he's going to say something, it's probably got meaning. He's probably selected these words. And this is only one word that he chooses to say. So why? What is he saying? What is he communicating? What matters in the middle of all this? You see, Jesus has a specific purpose in mind when he says this. And if we are not careful with it, we'll end up putting our own purpose into his words. You ever had that happen to you? That you said something? Probably if you're married, you've had fights about this. You said something. They heard something that you didn't say. And now they're mad at you for it. And then they're mad at you, so then you've got to be mad at them. I mean, come on. Like, that's what we do, right? And then only later we realize, oh, it was all a misunderstanding. I just didn't communicate clearly, or you didn't actually hear what I said. You thought I said something else. It's very easy for us to do that, to assign our own ideas to what you're saying. And so if we're not careful, we'll do that to Jesus. And there have been a lot of so-called theologians who have done this. A lot of those within liberal academia assign a completely different concept to what Jesus is saying here. They don't look at what Jesus actually says. They assign a different idea, and that creates a completely different meaning altogether. You see, as Jesus is here doing this, he's communicating something to us important. There's a temptation to place yourself in his position and to think that Jesus somehow said, I am finished, instead of it is finished. I mean, if I put myself in Jesus' position, I'm like, I was done before it started. Get me out of this, man. I don't want to do that. And when we do that, we run the risk of completely misunderstanding what Jesus is doing and what he's saying and what that means. You see, Jesus could have meant, if we go from the perspective, I am finished, he could have meant, I quit. This is terrible. Get me out of this. I don't want to do this anymore. Enough's enough. Or I'm overcome. He could have meant all those things if we come at it from the wrong perspective. And if we do that, then we create something totally different. We end up putting words in Jesus' mouth that he didn't actually say. So be careful to not do that. Be careful to not approach it from what you think it should say, or what you would have said, or what you've heard other people say about what he said. Let's look at what he actually says. What is he actually communicating? You see, it's this time. Jesus, just so that we're clear, he didn't say any of those things. Okay, he said, it's finished, not I'm finished. And so there's a very different meaning to that. It's time here for what Jesus is saying is it's time for the suffering and separation to be over and the joy of salvation to be experienced. Jesus illustrated this for us a little bit earlier in John's gospel. Turn there with me, if you would, John 12. We studied this before, but I want to show it to you again. It's been a little while since we've been in John 12. And if you were not with us during this time, then all of our studies are online. You can always go to redemptioncalvary.org and catch up on all of our messages. It's always posted online for you. Or any of these seven sayings messages are all there as well. John 10, Jesus gives us, or John 12, excuse me, verse 23, Jesus gives us an illustration. And the illustration is directly linked to his cross. It's exactly talking about the cross and where he's headed. Just a little side note, interestingly, as I was studying this, I remembered that this was one of the first Bible studies that I ever gave. I was in Bible college, and previously I had done, I guess what you would call Bible studies, but they weren't really Bible studies. It was more like there's a book and it gives you all the answers and I read through it and facilitated, right? So I'd done that, but studied the Bible, I'd never done that. So I took a Bible college class where they forced you to teach and I'm like, I don't want to do that. And so we got in these small groups and this is the verse that I picked. And I was so nervous because the teacher would walk around the room and he was standing off to the side and I saw that we met eyes and all of a sudden my mind went blank. And I couldn't say anything. I don't know. And so I just read some verses and sputtered some sentence fragments and probably did terrible. Some of the other guys were very kind. They encouraged me, but I know it was terrible. So I get another run at this one. In John chapter 12, we see verse 23 through 26, Jesus gives us an illustration of what he's talking about here, of his cross, of this finished work. Notice what he says. It says, "But Jesus answered them saying, the hour has come." The hour has come. This is the hour of Jesus going to the cross, "that the Son of Man should be glorified." Verse 24, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, then my Father will honor him, my Father will honor." Here Jesus is giving us an illustration, and it has kind of a dual meaning. What he's saying is the way up is actually down. The way to life is actually through death. And he grasps for us this concept of agriculture, which is something that we get. That especially here around where we live, there are constantly things being planted and harvested. And so you can drive by a field that in one season it's dirt, and in another season it's 6 foot tall stalks of corn. That's the way that it works. And the way you get the stalks of corn isn't from dirt, it's from the seed going into the ground. And if the seed goes into the ground and is buried, dies, it's sown, it's given up. You don't take that kernel of corn and eat it, you sow it into the ground. It has to die, it has to be given, it has to be invested. And once that happens, then from it springs not just another kernel. Complete ears of corn come out of that. That there's this thing that takes place when you sow into the ground. When you plant a seed, you get an entire plant. And what Jesus is illustrating for us here is a principle of being willing to sacrifice. That if I'm willing to sacrifice, that's how I'm going to gain. That I need to not just look to take, but instead look to give. That if I want my marriage to grow, I need to die to myself, not try to get her to serve me better. Right? Women are like, amen, preach it. If I want my children to grow and mature, then I need to not figure out how to manipulate them into doing stuff for me. Instead, I need to serve them. If I want to get that raise and promotion at work and be counted on at work, then I need to die to myself and be willing to do the hard stuff, not pass it off to somebody else. That there's this principle of dying to self in order to reap the harvest. But deeper than that, what Jesus is saying is that if I die, I will produce life. That my life, my body being sown into the ground, if you will, the same way that a seed does, is going to produce, generate life for you. That the only way that you'll be forgiven is through this. And so Jesus here, he grasps for us this idea that death must come before life can be brought forth from it. But here what Jesus is saying is that death is not the end. It's not the end. Death instead is the means of life. But that's what Jesus is saying. And so here as Jesus says this, he says, it is finished. Don't read into this in any way defeat. It's not at all a defeat of Jesus. He's not overcome. He wasn't tricked into going there. He said very clearly, I lay my life down of my own accord. No one takes it from me. He told that to Peter. That Jesus is not defeated, he's victorious. It looks like a defeat because he dies. It looks like a defeat because he's a bloody mess, nailed to a cross. He looks helpless and hopeless, and yet he's in complete control. And he's doing this on his own. The nails didn't hold Jesus to the cross. They may have placed him there, but it was his love that held him there. At any moment, he could have come off that cross of his own volition, of his own will. At any moment, he could have said, you know what, just not worth it. But he didn't. He stayed the course. He stayed the course and he took our sin from us. You see, this cry, tetelestai, is a victory. It's an investment in you. Go back to chapter 19 with me if you would. Last week we looked at this other saying of Jesus, this previous fifth saying. found there in John 19. We read it, verse 28, I thirst. And the focus of that was on the person of Jesus. He says, I thirst, right? He's thirsty, and we looked a lot in depth about that idea. But this week, we're looking at what Jesus says, it is finished, focusing on the work of Jesus. That here, this reality is that there is nothing more important for you to understand than these two ideas, the person and work of Jesus. It is by far the most important thing. And as Jesus is here communicating from his cross, about his cross, this is what he's saying to us. You got to understand who I am, and you got to understand what I'm doing. That there is nothing more important in all of our lives to understand, because your response to that understanding is what determines your quality of life. Will you live a godly life or an ungodly life? It's all centered around the person and work of Jesus. Not how hard you try, not how much Bible you memorize, not how often you attend church, not how much money you give, not how many mission trips you go to different countries. It's not based on that. It's based upon the person and work of Jesus. That's what it is. It's not religious routine. It's not going through the motions. It's Jesus. That determines the quality of my life. Do I live a godly life or an ungodly life? And it also not only stays there, but it also determines your eternal destiny. Is my destiny, am I going toward either heaven or hell? And the difference is the person and work of Jesus. It's all wrapped up in him. There's nothing more important of Jesus. So when Jesus said it is finished, there's a couple of things that he said, that he is saying. When he says it's done, there's four different things I want to point out to you about this, that Jesus, when he's saying this, that what he's communicating to us. The first one, he's saying that the Old Testament types, shadows, and pictures, all of them are completed. Now, if this is a new concept for you, it may be a little bit overwhelming. I know it was when I first heard about it. But the Old Testament is filled with foreshadowings of Jesus. Just like any good author, they start to foreshadow what's going to happen later on. God's a sweet author. He tells really good stories. And so as he's writing the story of human history, you might have noticed reading through the Old Testament that when you read about certain people, you go, that kind of sounds like Jesus. That's interesting. It's kind of weird the way that this connects. Well, it's not weird. It's on purpose, all right? So here's one of them, all right? I just want to give you one. There's tons of them, but I'll give you one. When Moses led Israel out of Egypt, they met with God, and God said, I want you to build a tabernacle, which is a big word for a tent that is a portable temple, essentially. I want you to build this. And in the building of it, there is this curtain or this covering that goes over the temple. And in this covering, there are multiple layers to the covering. And what we see is that the outside, the very exterior portion of this, it was actually covered in badger skins. Now, if you're designing a temple, that's probably the opposite of the direction you want to go. You want it to be opulent and look amazing, not stinky badger skins, right? Like sew some of those bad boys together and it looks brown. Like weird. I remember when I read that, I'm like, badger skin? Really, God? I mean, come on, you got all this stuff that you, okay, whatever. Well, there's something that's taking place here, because not only is the outside badger skins, but the inside is linen and gold and silver and all of this amazing, ornate, intricate design woven into it all. What it is, it's a foreshadowing. It's the whole thing, the tabernacle and temple. It's all talking about Jesus, from the showbread to the basin where you would wash your hands to the Holy of Holies where the blood would be spilled. All of it's about Jesus. The outside, the badger skin is talking about how Isaiah said that Jesus would be normal. He'd look like a normal guy. There's nothing special about Jesus. He didn't, you know, hover above the ground. That's not how you pick Jesus. Oh, he's the one that hovers over. He's glowing. See it? He's the glowworm. He's got the halo. None of that. Even though that's what the old pictures show you. You know, there's the one dude that's standing. He's got this face and his hands and halo, and that's Jesus. The scriptures tell us that he was normal. He looked just like any Jewish peasant of the day. He just looked like a regular guy. But inside he was divine. Inside, something else was there. It's a foreshadowing of Jesus. And when Jesus says it's finished, he says all of that foreshadowing, all of that prophecy about my first coming is completed. It's done. It's fulfilled. There's nothing left for me to do. There's nothing left for me to accomplish in order to achieve your salvation. Secondly, not only do we see that, but we see the physical suffering of Jesus is accomplished. When he says it's done, it's finished, his physical suffering is over. He's not going to suffer anymore. He doesn't have to go through the cross again. He's not going to be born again in a new place and go through life and die again for different people. He didn't have to do this for every generation. It's once for all. His suffering is complete and done. The resurrected body of Jesus, though, bears the scars of this time, though he doesn't go through the pain of it any longer. I think that when we get to heaven and we see Jesus, we're going to be caught off guard by how ghastly it actually looks. In Revelation, when you read of Jesus, it says that there was this lamb looking as though he was slain, sitting on the throne. And the word slain literally means slit-throated. I don't know if you've ever thought about that. Thinking of Jesus that way, that he bears the scars of my salvation. It's a different way of approaching Jesus and seeing him, and that for all eternity, he bears these scars of what it cost to save me. If I ever forget or think somehow that it wasn't a big deal, the body of Jesus will bear the reality. Thirdly, we see that when Jesus says it's finished, the work of salvation is complete. That's the one that we tend to think about the most. It's the one we tend to theologically gravitate toward the most, that Jesus completes the work of salvation, that he saves me, that I was drowning and helpless and hopeless in my sin, and he reached down and pulled me out of the depravity, the muck and mire of my life, and he set me on the rock of foundation that is him. Then when Jesus saves you, this has three implications. He saves you from the penalty of sin. You don't have to pay for your own sin anymore. He did. That's crazy. Secondly, he saves you from the power of sin. Not only the penalty of sin, but the power of sin, in that Jesus' strength is now available to you. That if Jesus overcame sin, he's going to put his Spirit in you, his power in you to overcome sin as well. And thirdly, he will save you in the future tense from the presence of sin. That in heaven, there is no more sin. That I have that to look forward to. That my body won't decay anymore, praise the Lord. That people won't do, I won't have to worry about if somebody comes by, are you telling me the truth? Are you just trying to scam me? Or what's going on? There's no more sin. That there's no more people doing evil, depraved things. There's no more need for prisons in heaven. We're saved from the presence of sin. So Jesus, and he saves us. He saves us from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and the presence of sin. Fourthly, we see that not only is Jesus saying the Old Testament types are fulfilled, that the physical suffering is completed, that the work of salvation is completed, but fourthly, the power of Satan is complete. It's over. Here's one that kind of throws some people, but Satan is called in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, the prince of the power of the air. He's called in 2 Corinthians 4, 4, the god of this age. When Jesus was in the beginning of his ministry, right before his ministry started, in Matthew 4 and also in Luke 4, we read that Jesus, he gave himself over to a time of fasting for 40 days. And at the end of that, Satan came and tempted him. I find it interesting that in the temptations that Satan brings to Jesus, he doesn't ever argue with Satan about the stuff that he offers. One of the things that Satan offered was, he said, I'll give you the world if you'll just worship me. Jesus didn't argue with him about that. It seems pretty clearly that he did have that authority, that Satan did have that authority. But at the cross, when it's finished, Jesus bought back. He bought back humanity. Not just humanity, but all of creation. That it doesn't belong to Satan any longer. But just like Jesus, just like when we purchase things, even though you own it, sometimes you've still got to wait for delivery. And that's where we are. We're in that little parenthesis of time. That Jesus has purchased it. It is his. It does belong to him. But he hasn't yet taken delivery. And that's the second coming of Christ. That's when he comes and he takes us home to be with him, and then he sets up his rule and reign on the earth. The death of Jesus purchased back not only humanity, but creation itself from Satan's grasp. And so we see that Jesus is saying that it is all finished. But thirdly and finally, we want to look at today what Jesus does. You see, this declaration of Jesus from the cross is not just about his work being accomplished, but that it was accomplished for me. That it happened for me. That we can't disconnect personally from what Jesus has done. Because we can tend to keep it in the realm of academic stuff or theological understanding. That we can understand something and yet still fail to appropriate it. Think of it like this. So if you have a rich, distant relative that you didn't know, they die, and they leave you a chunk of money. Like, yes, that's the best of all worlds. I mean, I'm sorry that you died, but I didn't know you, so I'm not really sad necessarily. And I get hooked up. Like, this is the best, right? No? Maybe I'm just evil. You're kind of getting a little bit of a view into my twisted head. So in that you have this relative that leaves you an inheritance, it's available to you immediately, but it doesn't actually belong to you until you receive it, until you take possession of it. So too it is with the cross of Christ, that he dies for all of humanity and he's offering salvation and redemption and transformation and adoption to all of us. He extends it. And yet it's up to us to take it. It's yours, but you've still got to receive it. That he's received you, you've got to receive him. So in this, Jesus is declaring that it's finished. But we can stop at understanding this as a theological idea, but we've got to step into practically living as if it is finished. Think of it like a master artist who's painting something and, you know, they're doing their thing, and I'm not really sure because I'm not really artistic. I have trouble drawing stick figures, and they're doing their thing, and then, you know, they've got to put some final dabs of paint wherever. And so they do the final one, they put down the brush, they step back, take a look, and they declare, it's done. Now, if I'm there and I happen to say, hey, you're painting, let me help you, and I grab the paintbrush, and I start to paint on the canvas, if that person's, you know, anything like me, then I'm probably going to get punched. And like, no, you're going to mess, you're going to destroy the beauty of what's just been produced. No. Simultaneously true, I can't say, oh, yeah, I think you messed up over here, let me get some paint thinner and rub part of it off. I'm going to destroy what's taken place, that it's completed, it's finished. So too with me, I can't add to the work of Jesus. I can't take away from the work of Jesus. All that I can do is take a position where I enjoy the glory of what it is. Hebrews 4 says this. Hebrews 4, 8 through 10. For if Joshua had given them rest, then he, the Lord, would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains therefore a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works, as God did from his. You see, he's calling us into this receiving of the grace of God and not trying to work for my salvation, but instead work from my salvation. It's not that you don't do anything. It's not that you don't do good works and you just sit around at home and be a bum. It's that you work as a result of your salvation. He did save me, so I do. Not, I'm doing this so he will save me. It's a completely different concept. You see, all you and I do is enjoy the glory of what is. I want to finish with this idea that there's at least three ways. And maybe you're smarter than me and you'll think of more, but here's three to start. There's three ways in which we live as if it's not finished. Number one, we can live as if the cross is not necessary. It's something that we can do. That in the way that we live our day-to-day lives and the way that we go through life, that we can live as if the cross is not necessary. I can think, you know, my sin's just not that bad. It's just, you know, I mean, okay, it's bad. But it didn't really require all that. No, Jesus disagrees with you. Even the smallest thing that you would count as not a big deal, he says it required my body being mutilated for you. It required my separation from the Father for you. That we practically tend to think, it's just not that bad. No, it's actually worse than you could ever imagine. It's actually worse than you could think. The cross confronts you with your depravity. That you can't look at Jesus and what he's doing and declaring from the cross and think, man, that stinks for him. No, you're confronted with yourself because he's not there for himself. He's there for me. He's there to rescue me, and that's what was necessary. Secondly, not only do we tend to live as if the cross is not necessary, but secondly, we can live as if the cross is not enough. That the cross isn't enough, that I carry the burden and shame of my disgrace. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for me and for taking my sin, but I've got to beat myself up a little bit over this too. I've got to pay some price for this as well. That it's just not, you know, I know you died for me, thank you, but I've got to do something else. I've got to somehow live under this shame and burden. No, Jesus bore your shame. Jesus bore your disgrace. It's not yours. So stop trying to carry it. Stop trying to live under that. It's not you. You've been given a new name. You've been given a new identity. It's beloved. That's who you are in Christ. Live in that. Stay there. Anything you do to try to add to the cross of Jesus is extremely offensive to God. You can't do anything, so don't try. Just receive what the Lord has done. Any sacrifices you make, any good things you do, anything you give, any shame you carry, they don't make God like you anymore. They don't make God receive you anymore. So lay that down. Lay it down at the cross. Thirdly, we can live as if the cross doesn't matter. Practically in our lives, we can just live like, it happened, but so what? We just live as if it didn't matter. I fail to yield the position of lordship to Jesus. That somehow Jesus died and he got me into heaven, and then it's like, well, thanks, I'll take it from here, and I just live my life however I want to. That we have a tendency to think, Jesus, I'm really willing to accept your salvation. I like that idea. You're going to save me from my sin? Sweet. But, oh wait, you want to actually control my life? You want to dictate what I do and where I go? I don't know if I like that. Jesus is Savior and Lord. He's either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. And I would challenge you to think on this and to say that if I'm not willing to submit to the lordship of Jesus, if I'm just willing to take his stuff and not receive him, then I would question whether or not you've really experienced salvation. I'd question whether or not you really know what it is to have yielded yourself to Jesus and to receive what he's offering to you. That in all of this, practically speaking, if you don't yield to the lordship of Jesus, you remain as your own God. You become, in this death of Jesus on the cross, he saves you from yourself, and he saves you to himself. The salvation is from you, from your depravity, from your sinfulness, from the penalty of it, from the power of it, and in the future, from the presence of it. But he saves you not just from that, but he saves you to himself. Jesus didn't die on the cross to make you God. He died on the cross to assume the position that he already had. That you are doubly now his. That you are his when he created and crafted and formed you in your mother's womb. That he knit you together, the scripture says. That he created you and crafted you that way. And then in rebellion, we run from him. And Jesus takes upon himself that rebellion and buys us back. And now we doubly belong to him. This is what the cross is about. This is what Jesus is saying when he says it's finished. There's a place of rest that we can find ourselves. And I just rest under the grace of God. I enter into that rest, receiving the love of God, receiving the grace of God. I pray that you find yourself in that rest today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word today. Thank you for the chance to study it together. We pray that you would help us to appropriate what your scriptures say. That Jesus, we would understand and grasp the weight of what you said when you said, "It is finished." That we wouldn't try to do anything on our own. We wouldn't try to earn your favor, but that we would receive what you have given to us. And that we would live in light of that reality. So Lord, as we today hear your word, we pray that you would help us to be doers of your word. We pray that you would increase our faith and grow us in your image, and that we would serve you well. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.